Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, Somerville. I don't even know what time of day it is because I'm just too excited about today's topic. Today is all about the clarinet. That's right, that beautiful, lyrical, warm woodwind instrument that I definitely don't have any bias towards myself at all. No, in fact, I don't think I even wrote the title of this, did I? You're simply the best. I may have. I don't know. Okay, I'm just kidding. I did grow up playing the clarinet, and I am so biased about it. But let's talk about it today because it is one of the most prominent and featured instruments of the woodwind family. It is now a staple part of the woodwind section in an orchestra. And we've heard a lot of really amazing clarinet solos this year, and we're going to hear more later this season. So it seemed like a perfect time to talk about this wonderful, wonderful instrument. I'm so glad you joined us today. Wherever you're joining us from, thank you so much for being here. We hope you have a good time and enjoy yourselves. So today is going to be a bit of a teaser, more of like a buffet, if you will. You get to choose, pick and choose which journey you get to go down. And I do hope you go down some good YouTube rabbit holes after we are done here, because I'm going to just give you little snippets and tastes, and then I will leave it up to you to find out other little pieces of information. So let's get started, shall we? By the way, this is certainly a very accurate video description here of what clarinet playing is actually like. Especially what my parents think I do, they definitely think I practice with a powdered wig on. But in all actuality, this bottom right-hand corner, what I actually do, it's pretty accurate. I mean, we pretty much sit in reeds all day, every day. I myself have this case of reeds, that I choose from, and every day you pretty much go through at least 8 to 10, because you never know what reed is going to work in any given room or any given situation. So it's certainly accurate, but I just thought we'd start off with a little bit of humor, even though it's very blurry and quality's terrible. Anyway, so let's dive right in. I'm going to move my face to this side of the screen. And let's look at all these different, very different clarinets. And as you can read on the screen, these are from very different periods of time, if you will. The left hand, on the left side of your screen, you'll see this early clarinet with four keys. And I want you to look at the date, circa 1760. It sort of looks like a clarinet, but it's only got four keys. Now, if you compare it to any of the middle clarinets in there that have a lot of different keys, it's obviously a very different instrument. So clearly there's been a lot of evolution in the last 200 years or so with this very instrument, and we'll get into that in a second. But I wanted to show you the different sizes, how they can look, the shapes, the colors. They are not a one-size-fits-all instrument, and we will dive more and more into that. Every part of this instrument can be sort of swapped in and out, and there's clearly a lot of variation here. So today we probably use one of two of these instruments: the standard German clarinet, as you can see here in the middle, sort of the gray background there, but also the boom system clarinet, which is the French clarinet, which will be to the right of it, sort of the lighter dark background. And these are sort of our main ones. The Öhler clarinet's not as popular these days, but either way, the middle of this chart represents sort of the mainstays, if you will, of today. And I myself grew up playing on a French clarinet, but as it is with many different instruments, it is different based on the region, based on the sound you want, based on what it's known for. It's the same thing you see with French horns, the same thing you see with, well, pretty much any instrument. So that's a good way to get started here. But it originated with this old instrument known as the chalumeau. Now, looking at it, you may think, well, that looks to me like a recorder. It looks sort of like kind of an old recorder here. And you're not wrong, actually. So the question on the table is, how are they different? And the biggest difference, as you'll notice on the left side of this instrument, oh man, it's flipping me up here. There we go. Is The need for a reed. There is literally a space where you must put a reed that is not a part of the instrument on top of it in order to play it. That's very different from recorders or from, you know, oboes. This is a very, very different kind of instrument. So you would need this cane reed and slap it on there and usually hold it down with something. Today we have very advanced sort of brass or cloth or something, different material ligatures, they're called, the things that hold the reed to the mouthpiece. But back in the day, you would have used pretty much anything, whatever would keep that thing tight on there. And so, as you notice, it has 8 tone holes. It doesn't have any keys except for this one right there in the middle. Looks like an old register key, but anyway. And we have these tone holes, which, of course, if you cover them and not, that gives you different tones. And it is definitely the predecessor to the clarinet. It is known, this chalumeau is known for its low, warm color. And that's originally how they began, is the lowest possible range. So you can imagine the flute played in the highest range, the bassoon was the bass instrument. This was sort of like the tenor voice, if you will, maybe the alto voice even, because the oboe is sort of the tenor voice of the woodwind family. And so this clarinet originated as that voice and the lower sort of warmer color of the woodwind family. And let's move on here really quickly. I wonder if I can actually play you this link. I'm probably not going to be able to, aren't I? I can, great. So let's actually dive in here and let me show you a little bit of this instrument.
Hi everyone, and welcome to what's going to be the first of a little series of videos talking about historical clarinets. The idea is to give short guides to a range of instruments in a way that can be used as an educational resource or also just if you're generally interested in these kind of strange 18th century clarinets. So I'm going to talk today about the earliest versions of the clarinet, which slightly predate the instrument we recognize. And these are from the 18th century, and they're called the chalumeau and the baroque clarinet. They're kind of...
So I want you to really quickly notice how different these instruments are. The chalumeau is much smaller. The chalumeau she's holding in her left hand, this whole mirror image thing is messing me up. And the baroque clarinet is in her right hand. Notice the size difference. And the biggest one we'll talk about, and I'm sure she'll mention it in a second, but notice how different they are. So this chalumeau is much smaller than our modern clarinet. So let's listen more. And by the way, check out what's holding the mouthpiece to the actual instrument. See if you can pay attention to that.
Like two halves of a clarinet, because the chalumeau only plays in the fundamental harmonic range, so what we think of today is the bottom register of the clarinet. Whereas the baroque clarinet is only really used on the overtones of the harmonic series, so what we think of as the second and third registers of the clarinet. And for that reason, they have different music written for them, and they have quite a different sound. Both these instruments are made of boxwood, and they've both got two brass keys at the top. These keys on this instrument do pretty much the same as on a modern clarinet. So you've got an A key, and you've got a register key. And if you hold them down together, you actually get a B natural rather than a B flat. On the chalumeau, it's a bit different because this doesn't play in the upper register. So this isn't a register key. This is just for playing the throat notes for A and B flat. And again, you can also get a B natural. What's interesting about this instrument is it comes in a family of different sizes. This is the soprano size. There's an alto, a tenor, and a bass, which are bigger. And the biggest one is about the size of a modern clarinet. It's about this kind of size. The chalumeau, even though it looks very, very small, because it only plays in the fundamental range, it has a strangely low sound.
I want to stop it there because it sounds so different from a modern clarinet in many ways, and it's fascinating to hear what an old chalumeau would have sounded like. And so let's keep listening.
In the fundamental range, it's got a really limited range of notes, so the notes I played you are almost all the notes it can play.
Okay, so she mentioned that it can only play pretty much the notes that she just played. Okay, well, that sort of ties into... I'm going to sneeze again, aren't I? I probably will. I won't. Okay. It probably ties into this idea of it being a very specific range in the woodwind family. And so it filled in these gaps of like, well, we don't really have much sound here. And so where the flute in its lowest range is weakest, where the oboe in its lowest range is weakest, the clarinet is probably strongest because of this low range. All right.
And that's why it's made in lots of different sizes. The Baroque clarinet... this one here.
You know what? I think we get the message. So let's dive back into this PowerPoint. I think we've established the fact that this is a warm sounding lower instrument. Now let's talk about the early clarinet. So this eventually evolved, and from one key we get to four or five keys. And this sort of originated in the turn of the 18th century, early 1700s, and they added the register key. This register key, which you heard referred to in the video. And what that register key does is it overblows the instrument by a 12th. Now, a standard octave is an eighth. So, you know, the same note, the one octave apart is an eighth. So it's an octave plus another half, plus another fifth, basically. So, for example, I'm playing a C. Then if I press the register key, I'm now playing a G. And that's basically the acoustical elements of the instrument. And so now you have all these new possibilities of playing a 12th above. So you basically doubled the size of your range, which is an amazing accomplishment because it gave the instrument that much more range. The tone was pretty shrill and loud, and it was a little bit different from the chalumeau you just heard. And it was actually very similar to early trumpets. And in fact, let's actually jump back into that video now that we've sort of talked about this one, because the Baroque clarinet she's referring to is exactly this. So let's actually jump back in and hear her talk about this.
It is quite different in sound and in range. So composers only really wrote for it from about middle C upwards. That's the same fingering as it is on a normal clarinet. And this instrument's pitched in D, so it's quite high. I'm going to play for you from its lowest kind of usable note upwards. So as you can hear, it's a much brighter sound. And for this reason, it became known as the mock trumpet, kind of used in a trumpet-like fashion in pieces. Composers that wrote for the Baroque clarinet include...
So that's a really, really good summary of that. And I think you just heard the early... It sounds like a clarinet, but it sounds a bit more shrill. It sounds a bit more piercing, if you will. And not to say that the sound of a trumpet is piercing in any way, but the colors are very similar to an old trumpet. And for that reason, it was called... clarinetto, which literally means little clarino. Old name for sort of an early trumpet was clarino, and so this was a little clarinet because it produces similar sound, and that's where we in fact get the name. Of course, clarinetto is the Italian name, and we here in the States don't say clarinetto because that's weird, and so we say clarinet, and that's how the name came to be. Now you can tell all your friends. And of course, over time, as you can hear, it pretty much, if you use the tone holes, it just gave you a scale. Well, composers started seeing a need for chromatic notes. Well, what about this chromatic note here and this chromatic note here? Well, how are we going to get those? And because they loved the range of the instrument, they decided, you know, we're just going to add keys and add tone holes in order for the instrument to be able to do those easily. Okay, great. And so over time, we begin with four or five keys on the early clarinet, and eventually we add more and more and more. And over time, as this happened, this was an evolution of gradual evolution, we eventually get to the orchestras of Mannheim. Now let's talk about why this is important, because this is really where the clarinet sort of came to be. Its coming out party was Mannheim, Germany. And I actually, by the way, really wonder, sort of a quick side note here, if you will, What would have happened if the saxophone actually existed during this time? Because thanks to Mannheim, the clarinet became a standard part of the orchestra. So now I can't help but wonder, man, would they have also standardized the saxophone in the same way? I don't know. Fun things to think about. But anyway, so in the Mannheim school, in Mannheim, Germany, there was, first of all, a lot of developments orchestrally. But if you look at the dates, these are pretty significant because it should give you an idea of history of which composers were coming around at this point. And also, if you think about the history of the orchestra, orchestral language development really began around the exact same time. And in large part, thanks to the developments at Mannheim, as well as the developments of the Neapolitan school in Italy and in France, etc., etc. And together they created sort of the standardized instrumentation, compositional process, etc. Now let's talk about some of these things because these are like just some of the developments that they gave us in Mannheim. So we're taking a quick little music history segue here because I want to show you exactly how much came to us from the Mannheim school. And in fact, if you read through these, the Mannheim Crescendo, Mannheim Rocket, Mannheim Roller, the Birds, the Climax, the Grand Pause, all of these originated in this time. And they're such standard pieces of orchestral music these days. We take it for granted. By the way, Mannheim Roller, not to be confused with Mannheim Steamroller. And that's a very different thing. That's about 200 years apart. Anyway, so let's talk about this really quickly. And let's actually jump back into our YouTube clips. All right. And let's actually talk about the musical memes of Mannheim. And these are brought to us by Musica Universalis, which is a great channel on YouTube. I highly encourage you to check out this channel if you have any, if you like their content and what they're presenting. So let's take a look at what the Mannheim School gave us.
The prominence and talent of the Mannheim Court Orchestra, the Mannheim School is what ultimately made these figures, or memes, popular across Europe. And this is why they are considered of Mannheim origin. The first and probably most famous of these classical memes is called the Mannheim Rocket. This is a quick ascending scale or arpeggio phrase that has been figuratively compared to a rocket firing up into the air. While we might consider this kind of an obvious thing, it wasn't really used in classical music until the Mannheim School popularized it. Let's listen to a few examples of the Mannheim Rocket in action. But first, a quick note. For every Mannheim meme technique for which I will be showing examples, I will always start with an example from Johann Stamitz of the Mannheim School to show the origins of each technique. Most music educators just show an example from Mozart or Beethoven, but I want to show you the source, otherwise the origins of these techniques remain an abstract matter. So let's get into it.
I love that, by the way.
Another one of these memes is what's called the Mannheim's.
Let's actually stop it there for a second because, by the way, the Mannheim Rocket, that name was obviously not given to that during the time these came to be. As you can deduce pretty quickly, rockets were not around at that time. So these are names that we've given retroactively to these devices. Now, I'm fascinated to know what they would have called them in Mannheim itself. Like, I wonder if they had any names for them or this is just what you did. I don't know, but fascinating thing. Here we go.
This is the practice of accenting descending pairs of notes or suspensions, which create a figurative sighing or lamenting musical effect.
Thank you.
Another important technique of the Mannheim School is what was called the Mannheim Birds. These are quick accenti grace notes, or appoggiatura, that give off a chirping effect. Hey, accenti. That's an interesting word. Where have I heard that before? Oh yeah, I made a video about it. Check it out.
Shameless plug, love it.
The last technique I will be talking about.
Before he actually jumps into the last one, I love the last one, the Mannheim Birds, which happens so often in music, and we'll talk a little bit more about who actually utilizes those really, really well in a second. But amazing, absolutely one of my favorite things. And by the way, shameless plug, speaking of shameless plugs, he gets the plug one, I get the plug one. So the College of Charleston Opera is presenting the Magic Flute this weekend at the Satilli Theater. If you don't have tickets yet and you don't have anything to do on Friday or Sunday afternoon, you must go check it out. The CSO, the Charleston Symphony Orchestra, is in the pit. It's a collaboration with the Department of Theater and Dance. The costumes, the sets are brilliant. The lighting is fantastic. It's not something you really want to miss. This is really grand scale opera at its finest. And I'm so proud of all of our students at CFC for just stepping up to this and just owning this show. They sound fantastic. So anyway, go check it out, because it's just going to be amazing. Anyway, let's dive into the last.
From the Mannheim School, is referred to as the Mannheim Roller, which is basically a rolling bass pattern consisting usually of octaves or eighth note tremolos over which melodies or progressions are built. So I know this was a lot to take in, and
so fascinating, because I think the whole point of this was to establish how important the Mannheim School is, and what they did, and how they transformed and revolutionized sort of orchestral composition. But that's just the scratching the surface of it all. We haven't even talked about the grand pause, or the Mannheim climax, or the Mannheim crescendo. But you know what? In fact, let's actually see if we can give you another example of a Mannheim rocket. This one should sound familiar. If it plays. Did you hear the quickly ascending arpeggio? Very, very exciting opening to this piece. Well, what happens right after that? Good old Mannheim Roller right after that. It's amazing. So Eine kleine Nachtmusik gives us many of these devices rolled into one. Anyway, let's dive into more. And so let's talk about how this affects the clarinet, because not only did they introduce all these devices, they also pretty much stripped orchestral music of the basso continuo, this really elaborate harmonic development in the bass line. They said, you know what, we're going to simplify that, and we're going to just have sort of more static harmonies in the bass, so we can elaborate more in the top voices. Well, they also standardized the four-movement symphony form. Up until then, it was a three-movement form, a sort of sonata form, and then a slow movement, and then a fast movement. And so they developed this four-movement idea, which now included the third movement minuet, the minuet and trio, which was a very much a carryover from Baroque times. They decided, you know, we really want to have this, and we like the minuet so much, we're going to include it in a symphony. And nobody questioned that for 200 years. Just kidding. But the last thing that was really, really special and important to us in this discussion is the fact that they started including clarinets as part of the woodwind section and as a solo instrument in the orchestra. Composers like Johann Stamitz, who we just heard, Graupner, Molter, and just many, many, many more, started writing for the clarinet. It began appearing in scores. It began appearing in opera pits. It began appearing everywhere, pretty much, thanks to the developments at Mannheim. Now that's pretty amazing, because if not for them, I wonder if the instrument would have actually gained traction. And so for the first time, you're seeing this standardized sort of woodwind collection. You have flutes, oboes, bassoons, clarinets. Not all together sometimes, but we're starting to see this early idea of, that is a woodwind section. We have the low voice. Now we have this cool new clarinet tenor voice, which is really, really cool. And so as you can imagine, this was pretty influential for many composers, including one famous one. Yeah, this guy, Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, who lived right during these developments at Mannheim. He visited Mannheim often. I think the first time he went there, I want to say he was 12 years old, when he was writing music already at 12 years old. And so he would be hearing all these developments, all these orchestral developments. And you saw some examples that that the YouTube channel used to kind of highlight these ideas in his music. Well, he also was one of the first ones to standardize the usage of clarinets in his orchestration. Now, not in his early symphonies, mind you, but later on, certainly. And in fact, he wrote one of the most famous clarinet concertos ever written. Oh, and one of the most famous pieces of chamber music ever written. So, thanks to Mozart and the Mannheim School, we really have to thank them for the clarinet really existing as an integral part of the orchestra and the opera pit. So, let's talk a little bit about this. To him, the clarinet most closely resembled the human voice. And that is a very important thing, because he started using it very much so in the opera pits to signalize that exact idea, especially when there's arias about love or heartache. The clarinet was sort of center stage. It would tie in perfectly into the voices on stage. You see a lot of tenor arias have this sort of duality with the clarinet. Soprano arias, we'll see some of those in a second. But the other thing that it began to be associated with was Freemasonry. And to Mozart, the clarinet was not only a folk instrument, an instrument of the people. And because of that, he believed, you know what, I'm going to use that as a symbol in my music to represent, hey, this is a theme of the people. And that's to him what the Freemasonry represented, and ideas of the Enlightenment and growing and developing as human beings and as a society. And so we have this beautiful juxtaposition of how he used the clarinet in his music. I'm just already getting so excited, but here's just a little taste of what he wrote in the solo repertoire. We already mentioned the very famous clarinet concerto, which is, by the way, standard audition repertoire for any clarinetist today, no matter what level, if it's professional, high school, college. It is a standard piece of repertoire. So one of the first and most important clarinet concertos written is still arguably has that title of most important. I don't know, you can argue that in many ways. But he also wrote a very famous clarinet trio for clarinet, viola, and piano called the Kegelstadt Trio, which I had the pleasure of playing in grad school. And he also wrote a beautiful clarinet quintet, which we are actually performing in Somerville on March 19th at Coastal Coffee Roasters. Make sure to come out to Coastal Coffee. Our clarinetist Nico is going to be performing that with our Somerville Orchestra String Quartet. Now, all of these pieces were written for a clarinet virtuoso by the name of Anton Stadler. Now, that's important because Mozart, pretty much whenever he met a virtuoso on any instrument, whether it's voice or a clarinet, he wrote them a lot of music. And you can see this happening more and more. Notice the dates of these compositions all towards the end of his life. That's where he really met and developed a partnership with Stadler, who really showed him what the instrument is capable of. Not even like Mannheim. Mannheim was sort of the exposition, like, hey, here's what this thing can do. And Anton Stadler took that and said, you know what? Let me really show you what this can do. And so it's a beautiful, beautiful way of using the instrument, thankfully for us. So let's actually give you some examples of how Mozart used the clarinet. And we're going to play for you. The first thing we're going to do is one of those opera arias. And I want to show you how Mozart uses and fuses, if you will, these two ideas. And this is from Clemenza di Tito, the Clemency of Titus, the last opera he wrote. And let's hear this beautiful clarinet solo. Actually back it up to the beginning. I'm not sure why it did that, but let's do this again. So beautiful, beautiful interplay. As you can see, when the voice is not singing, the clarinet pretty much takes over and fills in the gaps. There's a beautiful call and response. There's a beautiful duality here. And I think this perfectly illustrates Mozart's ideas of how it most closely relates to the human voice. It's a very agile instrument. You can get loud and soft very quickly. You can go through the ranges very quickly. It was a very flexible instrument, and because of its ability to sustain long air, it was, well, as you can see, very similar to the voice. Let's actually see another example now. Now, I believe this is, oh, we're getting ahead of ourselves here. Goodness gracious, I'm giving away the secrets here, but let's see if we can get another one in here. You know what we're going to do, actually, since we're here, let me play you a little bit of the clarinet concerto. We're going off script a little bit here, but I think it's important to play this piece so you can, first of all, hear what we're talking about in case you're not familiar. Let's actually back up to where this piece begins. Thank you. Beautiful piece, standard repertoire, but it still sounds as fresh as it possibly can. So it's absolutely wonderful. Just brings back such good memories for me of learning that for the first time and playing it. Anyway, memory lane's fun. So we mentioned all these things already. There's many more examples in the opera rep for Mozart. Magic Flute is full of clarinet melodies that sort of are very important. And one particular one is Die Bildnis, this interplay of the tenor aria and how he uses and fuses the clarinet within that tenor aria. And he's singing all about this beautiful image of this girl, Pamina, and how he's falling in love with this girl. And so, as you can tell, the clarinet is there to help him with his discovery of his love for her. Notice again, all of these years later on in Mozart's life. And this is important because it led to some developments, and namely among them is the influence of the clarinet in the last part of Mozart's life on other composers, especially in the Romantic era, beginning with Beethoven. Now, we see Beethoven as the logical successor to Mozart. Well, he also took the idea of the clarinet a usage quite seriously and pretty much standardized its usage in symphonies. Whereas in Mozart, you only see clarinets being used in 3 out of his 41 symphonies, and all of those, the later symphonies, like pretty much 35 and beyond, only use clarinets. Well, for Beethoven, all 9 of them use clarinets. And so it's pretty amazing how quickly this instrument gained traction. I think a large part due to Mannheim, a large part due to the music of Mozart himself. And so Ludwig van Beethoven used the clarinet even more than Mozart did, gave it a lot of important melodies and important situational repertoire. So let's actually take a listen really quickly to the full excerpt from Beethoven's Sixth Symphony. By the way, let's just look at this really quickly. When I start the video, I want you to see how long of a video this actually is, okay? So I'm going to begin this. By the way, the symphony itself is about 40 minutes long or so, and then I'm going to play for you the video, and you're going to look at the bottom right-hand corner of the video and tell me how many clarinet excerpts this symphony has, how exposed this instrument is. And we'll talk about that in a second. Anyway, so it's 7 minutes, 7 minutes of clarinet excerpts in a 40-minute symphony. Wow, okay, a large number of solos. Now, the symphony has a nickname, the pastoral. Now, the pastoral symphony, why is that an important element? Well, we talked about the clarinet's sort of folk identity. It's an instrument of the people. It was inexpensive to make. You can find it readily. It's not actually difficult to make one back in the day, the early ones, I'm saying. You know, a sort of a cylindrical bore. So it's you know, it was around a lot, and it was an instrument of the people. You use it in dance ceremonies and in weddings, at parties. It was everywhere, and Beethoven really highlighted the usage of that instrument and gave it sort of full symphonic treatment and really helped it not only gain sort of notoriety as a serious instrument of lyrical music, just like Mozart did, but at the same time highlighted its sort of folk and rustic background. So let's listen a little bit more to a little bit of the, let's actually jump ahead to, I think it's right around here. Thank you. So absolutely beautiful. As you can see, the beginning solo highlighted its sort of dance agility, sort of its fun characteristics. And this is obviously the second movement, this beautiful lyrical solo in it. But what's really, really cool about Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, oh my goodness, the Sixth Symphony, gracious me, is usage of bird song. Now, what on earth am I referring to? I'm so glad you asked. So the idea of bird song at the end of the second movement. That's a flute. Did you hear the cuckoo? That's the clarinet. So three out of the four woodwind instruments are playing birds here. Mannheim birds much? Comes around again. Beautiful, absolutely beautiful. So, as you can see, there was a lot of bird situation happening in this pastoral symphony. So Beethoven is highlighting these Mannheim developments. He's using the instrument in an extended way and giving it sort of the full royal treatment. It's a fun instrument, but hey, it's also lyrical. Oh, by the way, it's also capable of doing bird calls very easily. So a really, really beautiful highlight. He also, of course, wrote a clarinet trio, wrote a lot of symphony solos in Symphony No. 8, etc. And of course, thanks to Mozart and Beethoven, they were the gold standard, and so composers in the Romantic era began to look at them for ideas. And this list on the right-hand side of the slide is literally just, I took like the, I guess, the most prominent out of a long list of composers that wrote extensively for the clarinet. Well, now, when I say extensively, I mean exposed solos in repeated numbers of works, maybe a solo piece or two. But these are composers that really knew and highlighted the power of the instrument. Sibelius especially. Now, Sibelius is a composer known for his attention to nature and how much he uses folk melodies and pastoral elements in his music. Well, the clarinet plays pretty much a vital role in every one of his symphonies, in some way, shape, or form, not to mention his tone poems. Of course, Carl Maria von Weber wrote two clarinet concertos, which are very, very important in the repertoire. Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov, again, using a lot of folk melodies and folk elements, a lot of music. Hey, you see where this is all headed, right? And so we have a lot of this in large part thanks to the two gentlemen, Mr. Mozart and Mr. Beethoven. And if you look at the list of composers on here, actually, it's like Mozart, Beethoven, sort of Germanic, von Weber, Brahms, okay, Mendelssohn, very German-centric, Austrian-German. And then you look at the others, and it's like, well, Russian, Rimsky-Korsakov, Tchaikovsky, Rachmaninoff, and then Sibelius Dvorak, like sort of more Eastern Central Europe, but still influenced heavily by both the German schools as well as the Russian schools, those two styles together. It's very interesting to me that the most standardized sort of solos in the repertoire come from those schools of music. Now, that's another wormhole you can go down on YouTube, but not for today. We won't touch that. So, not only orchestrally, but also at the opera house, the clarinet began to be used extensively. And this is where the Italians really took the clarinet and highlighted its beautiful potential. Among them, Puccini and Verdi, probably being the two most prominent. Of course, Mozart gave extended clarinet solos in many of his later operas, including all three of the Da Ponte operas, as they're called. But Puccini was beautiful, and Puccini and Verdi, actually, both of them, wrote these beautiful extended solos for the clarinet. I'm going to play you arguably my favorite clarinet solo of all time. Again, an example of the clarinet being completely in sync with the human voice and interplaying with the voice. This is E lucevan le stelle from Tosca. Thank you. lamenting, emotionally charged clarinet.
Le luceva le stelle. Dolezzava la terra, strideva l'uccio dell'orto, e un passo sfiorava la vela, entrava ella fragrante. Fra le braccia.
Beautiful, absolutely gorgeous interplay of clarinet and the human voice, as you can see. And this is pretty much a highlight of what Puccini did with the clarinet and how he used it in his operas. There are many other examples, but another composer who really highlighted the use of the clarinet is Giuseppe Verdi. And this is a really, really famous solo from Act 2 of La Traviata. And I want you to listen to the similar sort of lamenting characteristic that he imparts on this clarinet solo. Absolutely gorgeous, absolutely heart-wrenching solo, as you can tell. If you don't know what moment in La Traviata that happens in, I think you can just tell by the clarinet solo what is happening around that story, part of the storyline. So that's just one of the examples. I wanted to play you this example from Vespri Siciliani, which is not a very, very famous Verdi opera, at least here in the States, but I wanted to show you this because not only does it highlight the clarinet, but I also wanted you to see this clarinet and how absolutely gorgeous it is. Now, most clarinets you see these days are sort of black, you know, either boxwood or rose mahogany, whatever. It's a very dark wood, but this has a beautiful color and shape to it, and so I wanted to play this for you so you can see it. I should jump back here to the beginning so you can see the whole instrument. Stop the video right there because this actually perfectly highlights many things. You can clearly see the reed and how it's attached to the mouthpiece, but what's holding it together to the mouthpiece is this ligature, what's called a ligature. And in the early video of the Baroque clarinet and the Chalumeau, you saw that it was sort of string or twine that held it together. Well, this is sort of a modern day version of that. This is sort of a Rovner style ligature, which essentially means it's sort of a cloth sort of textured material like that, that is used to hold this reed together. It ideally allows it to vibrate more easily. But Also notice one thing, and that's the barrel. Do you see how wide the barrel comes out? You know, and this is sort of something that clarinetists theorize over daily, and this wider barrel is supposed to give it this warmer, deeper, fuller sound because the air is allowed to mix in and sort of fill in together, and then boom, it gets shot through the rest of the instrument. So it ideally opens up the air, if you will. Again, debatable. We kind of have debates about this every day in clarinet land. Reeds, barrels, and what else? Ligatures, mouthpieces. That's pretty much our life. We tinker and tinker and tinker with these ideas. And so much of that has to do with, of course, how the instrument plays and sounds. And pretty much a lot of the sound that you will get out of a horn will come from the top part of the instrument that is literally on your screen right now. The barrel, and that's the length and the width, both of them. The longer the barrel, the lower the pitch. So you may be changing barrels based on which orchestra you're playing in, which continent you're playing on. Italian orchestras tend to tune to 441 or 442. We tune to 440. And so that requires different barrels sometimes, etc. Ligatures, it's, you know, sort of so personalized. You can get our ligatures that that articulate better, that are sort of allow the reed to speak easily. You get some that are more lyrical. But for the most part, you sort of find your sweet spot based on the kind of player you are. I myself am a very articulated player, so I like a ligature that gives me more lyrical sustain because I can articulate on pretty much any reed, any ligature. But I like a ligature that helps me play longer and warmer tone. Of course, reeds are a whole separate topic of debate because they come in all sort of various thicknesses and sometimes even widths. Yeah, like the literal tall width of the reed is a little bit dependent as well. And this is, again, so much of personal preference, but also has to do with your mouthpiece that you're using. How wide of an opening the mouthpiece gives you will dictate maybe how hard of a reed you'll be using on your setup. All of these factors come together to create this sort of beautiful mixture. And some players prefer more open mouthpieces. Some prefer more closed. The more open are more difficult to play, but arguably give you a deeper, warmer sound. The more closed are easier to play. And so that affects the thickness of the reed. As you can tell, this gets into a science and a personalized situation where you can spend literally weeks and months and years figuring out that perfect sweet spot. I like to think that I have my own sweet spot now. I have a beautiful Richard Hawkins mouthpiece with a Rovner ligature. That means probably nothing to 99% of you, but I'm really happy about it, so I'm just going to say it. Anyway, so we've highlighted Puccini, we've highlighted Verdi, and we see this beautiful instrument on top of it all. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. So let's dive in here into the PowerPoint again. Other composers that really wrote a lot of notable solos include Strauss, Donizetti, Bizet, Rossini, and here's where we're sort of the cosmopolitan nature of the clarinet comes into play. We see Italian composers, German, French, and it began taking off. And pretty much, it's as you can tell, by this point, late 19th century, it's standard in the opera house, in the orchestral score. It's pretty much always in these pieces, excuse me. And one of the other notable things is that composers saw how similar the clarinet was to the viola. And they used those instruments together, especially in the opera world. You'll see a lot of times that composers will write for viola and write the exact same music for clarinet. They are very much in a similar range, very much in a similar sort of color of sound. And so when you put them together, you have this beautiful mix. Hence why I think Mozart wrote that trio for clarinet, viola, and piano. And hence why many composers use it, because they just so fit so well together. And if you look at the voicing of that, the viola is actually known as the alto, a voice of the strings. In French, it's actually what it's called. It's called the alto. Well, if you look at that, first violins, your soprano voice, then your second violins, maybe your mezzo voice, sort of, if you will. And then the violas are the altos, and then, of course, the cellos and the basses, your sort of your baritone tenor slash, of course, bass voices. So the viola has this beautiful bridge in sound to the string sections. Well, the clarinet filled that exact same need in the woodwinds. And I think you're seeing that more and more in the way these composers wrote. So are you noticing any trends? Have you noticed any sort of commonalities and similarities? Yeah, it's a pastoral instrument. That's sort of its roots. It was easy to find, easy to play. And so you could as easily play some dance music, some fun polka, oompa band music, as you can these beautiful lyrical solos with it. You're noticing it's used in opera so much with the voice, arias of love, or actually later on lamenting arias, things that cry out in all the ranges. However, it's also one of the most agile instruments, as we saw, which in today's world means it's used a lot by composers for its agility and technical ability. In wind ensembles, concert bands, marching bands, the clarinets are really sort of the violins of those ensembles because of how flexible they are. They can play fast, they can play slow, they can play articulated, they can play legato, they can play in all the ranges and go quickly between them, which is really hard to do on many other instruments. And so for that flexibility, it's become one of the most popular instruments, not only in the band world, but the orchestral world, chamber and solo repertoire, etc. And I think that's for a good reason. It's the best instrument. Anyway, we talked about the pastoral elements and the dance qualities. Well, the 20th century comes around and brings with it this new idea of this dance craze, the jazz age, the jazz world, which again sort of highlights this sort of rustic dance quality, if you will, and the clarinet being an instrument you can find readily available, or maybe you played in marching band or it's brass bands, military bands. It's probably found there, so you can get your hands on one pretty easily. And lo and behold, it becomes a staple instrument in the New Orleans jazz sound. Now, eventually, the New Orleans jazz sound spreads, and the Charleston jazz sound has its own sort of unique sound as well, as we're learning more and more and more. And eventually you start seeing, you know, composers are saying, wow, we can really kind of highlight this instrument in a really, really cool way. Why don't we? And so I want to play for you a little excerpt. If you were at our concerts last weekend or something like that, you would have heard this wonderful piece by Edmund Thornton Jenkins called Charlestonia. Now, as I'm trying to find this exact spot here, Charlestonia is all a piece about Edmund Thornton Jenkins' hometown, which is Charleston, and he highlights the clarinet extensively. He himself was a clarinet player in the Jenkins Orphanage Band, but he also highlights the clarinet in this beautiful solo in Charlestonia. And I'm going to play for you a very interesting solo that right after it. Take a listen. That's the English horn. Here's the clarinet. Obviously a symphonic piece, but there's elements of folk music in there. There's folk tunes, there's plantation songs, work songs. There's a lot of different elements in that piece, especially some jazz elements later on in the piece. There's a lot of really cool jazz elements. Well, speaking of jazz, this famous George Gershwin dude wrote this solo to open his Rhapsody in Blue, and I want you to see if there's any similarities to that Jenkins solo you just heard.
Thank you.
Amazing, amazing solo. It's arguably one of the most recognizable musical openings in music history. In fact, it was voted the second most recognizable opening to any piece of music behind Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. That's pretty cool, standing for a solo instrument to have that recognition. I'm just saying, that just kind of highlights the point that it's the best instrument. I don't know, I'm just saying, you know. Anyway. So you've heard from Edmund Thornton Jenkins and you've heard from George Gershwin. Now, this sort of began a trend not only in American dance music and jazz and the usage of the clarinet in jazz music, which of course then we have clarinetists like Benny Goodman, who took the clarinet and made it world famous for its jazz qualities on top of these guys like Beethoven and Mozart. Well, to highlight that, Aaron Copland wrote this beautiful concerto for the clarinet, which is, again, world famous now, standard repertoire, which we will be performing in Somerville April 8th and 9th with our guest soloist Charlie Messerschmidt. And he wrote this concerto specifically for Benny Goodman, and he wanted to highlight many elements historically and what was happening currently in American music. He wanted to showcase the old traditions, the lyrical potential and capabilities of the instrument, but also then highlight its flexibility and its agility in the cadenza, this extended sort of jazzy cadenza. Oh, but then on top of that, he wants to highlight what's actually happening in American music around the time this was written, sort of this Americana sound, this also extended harmonic sound. And we have this beautiful combination of things, and I would love to play this for you. So we're going to jump around in this piece, and here's Martin Frost playing with the Norwegian Chamber Orchestra. Let's listen to the beginning, the lyrical opening of this piece. Absolutely beautiful piece. Absolutely beautiful opening to this. Let's jump ahead to like maybe, I'd say it's about here, about 6:45, which is the sort of the cadenza of it all. As you can tell, very agile, jumping all over the ranges, articulated very quick, sort of jazzy figures, jazzy arpeggios, jazzy chords. Later on, let's actually hear this sort of dance, this jazz dance that he has with the, oh, what happened to it? I'm not sure. But let's sort of jump into here. This sort of tell, the piece spans so many different styles and ranges. It's a really great example of how the clarinet and the clarinet concerto evolved from Mozart's time to Copland's time. Here we have this beautiful American example of what a clarinet can do. It's going to give us some jazz, some beautiful lyrical melodies, some dance music, some agile flexibility that showcases the instrument's potential, and Yeah, we just see it's all pretty much wrapped up in this beautiful Aaron Copland package. So I'm really excited to be doing that with Charlie in about 2 months or so with the orchestra. So, you know, speaking of clarinets in the orchestra in modern times, we see here in this picture this idea of what, I guess you could call it a standard clarinet section can look like. We have the smallest E-flat piccolo clarinet, which has a very, very specific high sound to it. Then we have the standard soprano clarinet. And then next to it, we have these really two cool examples, the basset horn, sort of alto clarinet slash basset horn land, which is much lower, a little deeper and darker. Mozart used it very frequently in his music, particularly in Magic Flute. It calls for many bass, goodness gracious, basset horns. And to the right, of course, recognizable for its distinctive sort of snake S-shaped neck, is the bass clarinet, the lowest member of the standard orchestral section. These are highlighted extensively in various pieces. Mahler is a perfect composer who uses these frequently in his writing. In his first symphony, we see this klezmer, again, this type of folk music, this type of dance music, if you will, and he uses it extensively in Mahler in his first symphony. So let's actually take a quick listen to that as one of the last things we'll listen to today.
Hi, I'm James Zimmerman, principal clarinetist of the Nashville Symphony, and I'm here with my friends Cassie Lee, Dan Lockery, and Sam Bacco on percussion back there to demonstrate one of our favorite parts from Mahler 1. Mahler is famous for saying that a symphony should contain the world, which means sometimes in a Mahler symphony, you might hear something out of left field that totally catches you by surprise. And in this case, we have not one E-flat clarinet, but two E-flat clarinets at the same time playing a little klezmer duet. Klezmer is a music that Mahler probably heard in his childhood, very nationalistic type of music. The E-flat clarinet is the smallest clarinet in the clarinet family, and they play a duet in the middle of the very tragic third movement, which sounds like this. Nobody's really sure.
So amazing, again, how different in tone the E-flat is. It's much smaller, so it's higher pitched. And you can kind of really get this sort of folk sound to it, which is much more, I think, pastoral in nature than even the regular clarinet, as it were. So it's pretty amazing. But it's sort of to highlight how different these clarinet sounds can actually be, I wanted to actually play you a very extreme example. Neither one of these instruments are in the standard clarinet section in the orchestra, but I wanted you to hear the range of this instrument. So as you can see, this piccolo A-flat clarinet, which is even smaller and higher pitched than the piccolo E-flat clarinet we just heard in the Mahler symphony, and the contrabass clarinet. Not just the bass, it's a contrabass, so like an octave lower than the bass clarinet. So you have literally the most extreme ranges in the clarinet family here playing, of course, Tchaikovsky's Nutcracker. But to highlight just the very vast range in sound you can get from this instrument family, I wanted you to play that example. And so, of course, you can dive into YouTube and find an octabass clarinet even more than the contrabass, but that's not for today. It's not for today. So, of course, it's, as we mentioned already, the clarinet's readily found all over the place. And in fact, you can even make your own. And I want to just show you, this is a really great TED Talk by Lindsay Pollock from TEDx Sydney. Many of you may like TED Talks. And this is a really great one. I'm just going to play you about 30 seconds of this. And he basically makes a homemade clarinet from a carrot. I kid you not. Listen to this video. It's wonderful. I'm just going to show you
definition that I like of creativity is the putting together of two previously unrelated things, could be objects or ideas, and creating something new. So I'm going to take a carrot and a saxophone mouthpiece, and I'm going to give you a very quick demonstration on how to make your own instrument. Because I think the thing we forget is we tend, crazy because music is such a communal activity, but we tend to leave music in the hands of the experts, and we all of us consume music. But you yourselves can become carrot clarinet players very easily.
So we're going to skip to the part where he actually creates this carrot clarinet. He basically hollows the carrot out, creates tone holes, drills them out with literally a power drill. And eventually we get this beautiful and unique instrument.
Oh, sorry, we've run out of time. I have to go. I've got 57 seconds left. Here we go.
To create a clarinet out of a carrot, but I wanted to leave that to put a little kernel of an idea in your head as to how this instrument may have potentially been created in history. I mean, all you need is a pretty much a cylindrical thing that you can attach some sort of mouthpiece element to and make sure it can have a bell to it that projects the sound a bit more, and you might be able to get that sort of sound. What's amazing is that this clarinet sounds to me like very much like a lot of the Middle Eastern type of clarinet cousins, sort of the early instruments that maybe had developed from around that region of the world. These early like predecessors to the recorder, the names of which escape me now, but I think it just, another wormhole you can go down here is the history of these type of instruments. You can sort of hear this quality to it that's obviously not a Western type of quality of sound, but I encourage you all to do your own deep dive of research into this. But of course, to sort of wrap up today, it's obviously one of the most popular instruments of our time. It's used all over the place in orchestras, bands, chamber music, operas, solo repertoire, even dance bands, jazz music. It's used everywhere. And so its popularity is very much linked to its flexibility, its ability to adapt to pretty much any instrument group and play and fit in quite readily. Its range helps, again, fit in with most ensembles. It can play low in its Shalumeau range, as it's now called today, the Shalumeau lowest, warmest, darkest range that you can hear in the beginning of Tchaikovsky's Fifth Symphony, as easily as it can play in the stratosphere, in the highest ranges, as highlighted by composers like George Gershwin and Aaron Copland. And you know, many other examples, but anyway. But I would play the comedy sketch for you, but, well, we just don't have much time. I'll give you a little teaser of it, though. This is pretty pretty funny, though. This is what happens when someone who's never played the clarinet before tries to play it. That's fantastic. Please check out two set violins, professional versus beginner clarinet video. It's hilarious. You'll get a good kick out of it. Of course, the gentleman on the right is a professional clarinetist, and he plays the exact same thing that the other beginner tries to play. Various results, as you can see. But it highlights the instrument's sort of ability to frustrate many a beginning player. And myself, I remember being very frustrated the first 3 years or so of playing the instrument. But anyway, I wanted to leave that on a sort of a happy note. And I wanted to thank you so much for joining us today for our foray into the history of the clarinet and what it can do and how it can sound. We hope you enjoyed this musical adventure today. I'm so thrilled that you were able to stop by and join us. If you have any questions, of course, let us know. Write it in the comments below. I'm sure we'd love to hear from you. Let us know what you thought, if you enjoyed it. What was your favorite part of the video? And where do you think you're going to be researching after you've watched this now? What do you think you'll be diving into? So let us know. We'd love to hear from you. Thanks so much for tuning in, and we can't wait to see you next time for our next Music Chats with Wojciech. Thank you so much, and we'll see you in a month.